Welcome to the 13th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2023. Our first item on the agenda this morning is our final evidence session on the Children, Care and Justice Scotland Bill. And can I welcome Natalie Dawn, Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise, good morning, who is joining us for the first time since being appointed. Good morning, welcome and congratulations. Alongside the Minister today are officials Brendan Rooney, who is the Bill Manager, Deborah Nolan, the Bill Team Professional Advisor, Hazel Crawford, Head of Children's Residential Care Unit, and Barry McCafferty, Solicitor, Legal Directorate. We will begin with an opening statement from the Minister. You have 5 minutes, and I will be keeping you to time today, given our bit of an issue with technology. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Members. Can I just start by putting on record my appreciation for the Committee's diligent work on this bill to date, to all witnesses who have appeared before you and those that have responded to your call for views. These efforts have made a huge contribution to the important discourse on how we can improve Scotland's approach to children and young people who come into contact with our care and justice settings. Turning to the bill, Scotland and all the parties in this Parliament committed to keeping the promise by 2030. The Government's implementation plan for the promise was published just over a year ago and received cross-party support. The bill takes forward various key aspects of the promise. It advances rights under the United Nations Conventions on the Rights of the Child, and it brings consistency across various parts of legislation to the definition of a child as a person under 18. This approach builds on our Getting It Right for Every Child principles and youth justice vision. You'll be aware from evidence to committee that there are currently inconsistencies in how Scotland treats particular 16 and 17-year-olds. By raising the maximum age of referral to the reporter, the bill takes action, addressing many such discrepancies in how they experience the children's hearing and criminal justice systems and how these two systems interplay. This provides all children the opportunity to access the hearing system in cases where they may need the care and protection of that system or in cases where they are in conflict with the law. Importantly, this bill does not disturb the constitutional independence of the Lord Advocate. Procurators Fiscal will retain the discretion to prosecute children and young people in court where deemed necessary. The bill makes provisions to improve the safeguards available to all children in the criminal justice system. Scotland's courts will still be able to deprive a child of their liberty. Yet, in line with the promise, the bill makes it clear that detention should normally be in a secure accommodation rather than a young offender's institution, at least until that deprivation needs to end or they turn 18 years old. Now, I know that members of the committee have visited secure centres across Scotland and Polmont, and you will have seen, therefore, that YOIs are not primarily designed as bespoke environments for children. Secure care centres are established to be trauma-informed and age-appropriate settings. They offer a high staff-to-child ratio of skilled professionals with the specific qualifications required to meet complex care and support needs of these young people. Secure care can, and indeed already does, care for those children who pose the greatest risk of serious harm. The supervision and support arrangements in secure centres are intensive, and you will have seen from your visits that when a child is placed there, public protection and safety are critical elements. Facilities are locked. So I know that stakeholders unanimously expressed support for ending placement of children in YOIs, but also concerns have been raised about capacity and resourcing. The Scottish Government is not complacent in this area. That is why the Reimagining Secure Care project, which the Children and Young Persons Centre for Justice is undertaking on behalf of the Government, is running in tandem with the bill. Moreover, a national implementation group for the bill is due to start its work in early June. Turning to the matter of cross-border placements, none of us want children and young people to be removed from their communities and placed far away. However, these arrangements need to be able to happen in some exceptional circumstances. I'm aware the committee has heard some powerful evidence of such situations. But there must be rigour in how they are planned for and implemented in order that these placements are not detrimental to children's rights. This bill will provide powers to ensure that. For temporary placements, responsibility rightly remains with the placing authority who know the child and plan their care. The bill also gives further and more flexible powers to make providers more accountable for these types of cross-border placements. This enables the introduction of further requirements on residential providers alongside extra powers for the Care Inspectorate in relation to placement providers. I know that stakeholders have expressed support for the bill, but also raised considerations about resourcing more broadly. And we're acutely aware of the need to work with partners to prepare for the bill and ensure systems, settings, policy and practice are ready for it. That's why the multi-agency implementation group planned for June is absolutely crucial. That inception meeting of key partners will help us explore resource and capacity requirements in more depth, whilst co-designing governance and oversight for measures. So I hope these opening remarks have been helpful for you, and I look forward to answering the committee's questions.
Thank you very much, Minister, for being so good with your time there. We will now move to questions from the committee, and I'm hoping, in the interest of time, that our answers will be... one person will be able to respond to the questions. Can I move firstly to my colleague Stephen Kerr, who will open things up today.
So why 18? Why 18 for the age, the new definition of the age of a child up to the age of 18? Why?
Well, the United Nations, the UNCRC defines a child as under 18. That is something, as I said in my opening remarks, that has cross-party support. 16 and 17-year-olds are, as I say, still children, and they have the best chance of being rehabilitated.
But can I ask why do we go in chronological age at all? Why don't we go in the age of accountability, of responsibility? Some of these 16 and 17-year-olds that we're talking about probably have the mental age of someone much younger. So why are we stuck on chronological age?
Well, I think, as I've said, we are committed to incorporating the UNCRC, and that defines a child as under 18. I think, obviously, in Scotland, there are a number of definitions of a child, and there are age-based laws that allow, for example, 16-year-olds to live independently. But I think that complexity does not necessarily mean incoherence. So in some instances, it can be appropriate to treat young people in the same way as adults. That will strengthen their rights. But in other contexts, such as what we're discussing here, such as diversion from the criminal justice system, treating young people in a different way from adults will strengthen their rights. Treating them in this way within the criminal justice system will have the best chance of offering rehabilitation.
But you can get married when you're 16.
Yes, but as I've just said, complexity does not necessarily mean incoherence. I mean...
It seems somewhat incoherent to me. You can get married at 16, but you're saying that the age of child now is 18, and your government just brought forward legislation that was going to give children as young as 16 the ability to change their gender legally.
Yes.
So this is incoherent, isn't it?
I don't believe so. I think that, as I said, treating them within this respect, within the criminal justice system, is a very specific issue. Children that are 16, 17 will still be able to make decisions for themselves. However, under the criminal justice setting, and treating them like this will give them the best chance of rehabilitation. We know that children at 16 and 17... may not be able to make decisions. They necessarily don't make decisions based on kind of long-term thinking. And also children that are 16 and 17, dependent on how they've grown up, the things that they've been brought up with, may not necessarily understand the full law and what is right and wrong. They might not have a clear depiction of that.
I agree with you on that
so
point.
So in terms of that, I believe out, that 16 and 17-year-olds should be treated as children within the criminal justice
system. Yeah, I'm just pointing
out
that there are some grave inconsistencies now.
Well,
after this, should this change become legislation, there are definitely inconsistencies which are really hard to stand up. And Minister, surely you must agree with that.
As I said at the beginning, I don't believe that complexity...
I know that's your answer, so I'll move on. Let's talk about... there are inconsistencies.
There are inconsistencies.
Yeah, and they don't stand up.
But I don't believe that blanket 16 for all these different things that you're discussing is appropriate.
No, I know.
Mr Kerr's already said he's looking to move on.
So I'm going to move on. Children's hearings. This is going to increase the capacity. we're going to have an increase in capacity in children's hearings. It's going to increase the demand for the services of children's hearings. What do you estimate that that demand increase will be?
So that is a good point, and I know that the committee have taken evidence that has raised sort of concerns around capacity for the children's hearing system.
Yeah.
We do expect that there could be up to 2,400 hearings, but we are working with we're working with the key stakeholders to ensure that capacity is in place.
Somewhere between 10 and 20% of an increase in demand for children's hearings. That's what it's going to be, isn't it?
I believe so.
And the number of new volunteers that the children's hearing system is going to have to find?
So I don't have those figures in front of me, but I would be happy to pass to officials if they are aware of the detail in that.
You'll see the financial memo's got quite an outline of the capacity increases that we envisage coming from this.
And I
know Children's Hearing Scotland were in front of the committee and have given. We've worked very closely with Children's Hearing Scotland and SCRA on the forecast. I know that the financial memo talks about
how many is
the number of hearings. I know CHS's latest is around 300 or something about
300.
Quite recently.
That's not going to be very easy, is it, Minister? 300 more volunteers in such a short space of time. What are your concerns about what might happen on the basis of the fact that it is quite difficult to recruit these people currently?
Well, I think what's important is that we've heard evidence that this is going to be possible. This change is supported.
Do you believe that?
Yes, I do. I do believe it. As I said, the committee has heard evidence to this, so it's not necessarily whether I believe it or not.
No,
stakeholders you are saying.
You can hear evidence and you can decide for yourself whether you think the evidence is consistent with what is rational or feasible. Do you think it's feasible for the children's hearing system to be able to cope with an additional recruitment on top of the attrition rate it already has to deal with, and that is an issue already, that they're going to be able to have a net increase of 300, do you think that is feasible?
I think it's feasible. I don't think that we would be carrying this out if it wasn't feasible. And I do, and as I've said, Children's Hearing Scotland have said that they can cope with this increase in capacity. So I think the evidence is there for Mr. Kerr.
What happens if they can't find their volunteers?
Well, I don't really like to speak in kind of hypothetical terms. This is something that
we've said
that this is going to be possible.
Have you considered what might happen if we can't get the volunteers?
Well, this is something that's been worked through and discussed, and this is an ongoing process. So if there are issues, or we see that there will be issues with capacity in terms of that, then that's something that the Scottish Government will absolutely...
All I will say to you, Minister, is that the recent record of recruitment is that there's a fall-off in the number of volunteers, particularly in the last few years. There's been quite a fall-off. So there is a real risk that the number of volunteers that are required will not be possible to recruit. And I think it would be responsible of government to be considering what that scenario might look like, given the nature of the demand that will be put on the children's hearing system. What about training? Are you completely satisfied that the children's hearing system has the capacity to give the high quality of training required, given the fact they're going to be dealing with this age group and perhaps a different range of offences?
I mean, I am satisfied. I am confident in that. And again, this is something that Children's Hearings have said that this will be possible. Obviously, we have the working group underway. And if there are any issues or concerns going forward, then that will be something that we will work through.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister. Now, the Scottish Sensing Council, you'll know, have guidelines for sensing our young people, and they apply to a young person who is under the age of 25 at the time of entering a guilty plea or when they are found guilty of an offence. And this has been some cases recently on this. Were those guidelines considered when the bill was being drafted? And if so, why doesn't the bill go further to provide consistency, with regard to the age of a young person in the criminal justice system?
So the Sentencing Council, rightly so, have a statutory duty to periodically review the sentencing guidelines it publishes. The Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs intends to meet with the Chair of the Sentencing Council to discuss that work. And when doing so, will raise the general question of how the Council plans to keep its guidelines under review, including the guidelines on the sentencing of young people.
My question was, were they considered when you were drafting the legislation?
Yes, it was considered.
OK. And obviously there's been quite a lot of press coverage on the public outcry on some of the issues around these sentencing guidelines and the people of that age. So do you have anything to comment on that?
It wouldn't be for a minister to comment on a live case.
OK, convenient. The committee also heard from Social Work Scotland that while the bill had the right aspirations and goals, there is a lack of confidence about our ability to deliver due to the resource impact in social work. Same theme as the questioning from Mr Kerr. So how will the Scottish Government support local authorities and their social work teams to implement the bill effectively?
I think that's a kind of similar vein to the questioning from Mr Kerr.
It is indeed, yes.
Yes, and as I've said, we are working with the key stakeholders. The Scottish Government is working with the key stakeholders and those involved to ensure that we can implement this. We are aware of persistent challenges around staff recruitment and retention in the social care sector, and these issues have obviously been exacerbated by the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic. However, the Scottish Government block grant to local government of £13.5 billion is an increase despite the most challenging budget settlement since devolution. So the financial resources are there. But in terms of support, that's something that the government will be working with local authorities on.
What support are you looking to put and give to local authorities regarding their social work teams, not social care services, and because we have heard about the recruitment challenges and some of the training that's going to be required. So it's back to what are we doing now to make sure that everyone can go from day one?
In terms of the specific support for social work, I think I would probably hand over to my official who might give a more clear response
okay,
to
over
that.
To you, Mr.
Yeah,
Reed, Brendan.
I can do. And obviously the financial memo kind of predates Mr. Don's time in office. So, the process we went through to quantify those effects that will stem from the implementation of the bill, we're engaged with Social Work Scotland and COSLA quite early on that. They were obviously done in the kind of final third of last year, so they give a snapshot of forecasts of increases to social work resource and capacity that we needed in terms of implementing the bill. However, we do know there's evidence coming forward at stage one from Social Work Scotland and COSLA. I know they've sent in specific responses to...
Yeah, we'll come to questions on that COSLA submission later on, I believe. So
which
I don't
kind
want to
move the issue forward. But again, in terms of finances, there's a lot of variables in terms of, the bill enables 16 and 17-year-olds to go, all 16 and 17-year-olds to go to the hearing system. There are still those kind of decision frameworks that the committee's heard about, like the Lord Advocate's guidelines and like the joint referral framework with SCRA and the Crown Office, which I suppose will give more rigour to how those decisions are actually taken. So the forecasts were based on quite a lot of variables, but we have quantified them up for what we think with social work, but we continue to work with Social Work Scotland. The implementation group that Ms Dawn alluded to next month will be quite key to that. We know there's been quite a lot of developments since the financial memorandum, so it's a kind of evolving policy space, and we're very cognisant of what is coming forward at this and other committees. To look at those figures and keep those kind of discussions alive.
I'm not quite sure there's anything there that would inspire the confidence to Social Work Scotland, but can I move to questions now from Ruth Maguire, please? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. This bill, as you say, is about advancing children's rights. I'd like to cover some areas where concerns have been raised kind of in that regard, specifically around compulsory supervision orders. Concerns have been raised with us that the imposition of an MRC could amount to the deprivation of liberty of a child or young person without legal safeguards. Have you had an opportunity to consider whether there's more that needs to be done in that regard in terms of access to legal representation for young people?
Thank you for the question. MRCs obviously are designed to be less restrictive than secure care. Expanding the circumstances around that will mean more children can be supported in this way, although I appreciate the member has concerns around that. But that is where it is deemed appropriate. Safeguards already exist under the Children's Hearings Act 2011 and still do apply, so I don't feel that they need to be added to this bill. the children's hearing is not a sentencing tribunal. It makes decisions to safeguard and promote the child's welfare throughout their childhood, not necessarily to punish a child for their actions. So an MRC, like any measure through the children's hearing system, can only be imposed if this is better for the child than not.
You mentioned there, and highlighted rightly in your statement, the intensive support that accompanies MRCs. Can you give assurances that there will be that intensive support whenever an MRC is imposed, and also talk a little to the additional resources that will be required to do that?
Yeah, absolutely. So it's further to my previous response. An MRC is always associated with the child receiving intensive support. So the details of the intensive support that the child will receive will be contained in the movement restriction child's plan. The plan must be practicable to address the immediate and the longer term needs of said child, with a view to safeguarding and promoting that child's welfare. So MRCs in themselves can be highly individualised and flexible, and that will be taken on a case by case basis dependent on the child.
So just for clarity, I think the specific concern was because it was being decoupled from secure care, that the support package would not go with it. Are you being absolutely clear that there will be a package of support for a child who is on a
Yes,
MRC?
As I say, it will be deemed on a case-by-case basis dependent on the circumstances surrounding that child.
Okay, thank you. The other change is in terms of the criteria, with it being described as psychological harm, and that being a subjective test. What consideration has been given to this in terms of children's rights, and what specific safeguards would you put in place to ensure that they were only used in the appropriate circumstances?
So the new provisions that recognise the current criteria of injury, that injury, this isn't necessarily a change, it's just a kind of redefinition. So injury always
encompasses... Forgive me though, Minister, because the change that I'm asking about is a move from something that has a... I'm losing my words now, give me a second. So the change to psychological harm is a subjective test. There was some objectivity, I think, in terms of reasonable person, perhaps. I might be getting that wrong, if I am, forgive me. But that's the specific change that I'm looking for your reflections on.
And it was in terms of safeguards you mentioned, Jay. Mm-hmm. I mean, appropriate safeguards remain that any measure must be absolutely necessary, proportionate and in the child's best interests, and obviously in limited circumstances to protect the public from serious harm. As I've said, although you're saying that's subjective, this was something that was always contained within the definition, because psychological injury or psychological harm was always included in the current criteria of injury. Sorry, I can see you.
I don't want to interrupt. I just feel it's really quite an important part. I'd appreciate that you're newer to this bill, and I don't want to... But I do think the evidence we've heard is that there is concern that it's a move to a subjective test rather than having the objective safeguard in there of reasonableness.
Well, it is and always has been a matter for the panel members to decide what impact the child behaviour has either on themselves or others, and whether that criteria is met. I think that I'll bring Debbie in for this, just because I know that you... would like to give him more information on that.
Yeah, so I think our position is that there has always been a level of subjectivity there. The test has previously been the same as the secure care test, as you mentioned, so that was likely to cause injury to another person. So what we've tried to do is recognise in this context that injury might be broader than physical injury, which actually... the previous test didn't specify physical injury, but our concern was that that was how that was being interpreted in practice. Panel members always had to determine that this child was likely to cause injury to someone else. Now it's likely to cause physical or psychological harm. So we don't deem that it's necessarily a broadening, and we don't necessarily deem that it's more subjective. However, we are obviously listening to stakeholders that have told us they feel that it is too subjective, and we will revisit this, and if that's the conclusion that we reach, we can look at making some amendment to that criteria. But our position as it stands is that we don't think it's too broad or too subjective. We think that's building on what's already there.
I think so. You're saying building on it. I find it quite interesting to say that you feel there's no change when it clearly is widening it. And I'm not necessarily disagreeing. I just think it's important to be really clear about, you know, any potential risk in broadening it or any potential benefit. I mean, it's not more of the same. It is different.
I think there is a clear benefit there. Right now, the test is about injury. So actually, if that is narrowly interpreted as physical injury, then when we have a context where, for example, a child was stalking another child, or maybe there was domestic violence or coercive control in the relationship, if we narrowly took the interpretation of injury as physical injury, those types of behaviours wouldn't be covered, and therefore that child wouldn't be able to be considered for a movement restriction condition. So therefore, what we try to do is broaden that recognition to recognise a wider range of behaviours. And I think partners in victims' organisations, as well as Police Scotland, have been supportive of that change, recognising that this does cover a broader cohort of behaviours. In terms of the potential risks, that there are risks with any change. We know that. However, we are not going to introduce the legislation without considering the guidance, training and the support that decision makers require alongside that to implement these changes in practice. And that will absolutely be a focus of the implementation group. What sort of provisions need to be put in place to support decision makers to use these changes in practice and minimise any potential unintended consequences or risks that might come from this change.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Convener, one more question.
One more before we come to Mr. Dodds.
My final question is just about the effectiveness of MRCs. The policy memorandum for the bill says that no evaluation has been carried out on the effectiveness of MRCs. So can I just ask how their effectiveness will be evaluated going forward, Minister?
Thank you. And again, another very, very important question. I think, as I've previously said, an MRC, like any measure through the children's hearing system, can only be imposed if this is better for the child than not, and it is necessary, and where it meets the welfare of the child as a paramount consideration. It's also in recognition that an MRC is intended to be a restriction on a child's liberty and not a deprivation. As I said at the beginning, this is the most extreme prior to secure care. If a child, in terms of effectiveness, if a child does not comply with an order, the local authority must notify the children's reporter to require a review of that order. A children's hearing will reconsider the child's whole circumstances to consider if any additional or alternative measures are needed to address the child's behaviour. The scheduling of those hearings are prioritised given the potential for more or the potential requirement for more restrictive measures to be put in place. And as with other elements of a child's plan, including the risk management plan, monitoring and review, including whether risk and vulnerabilities and potential adverse outcomes is absolutely key. So this will be something that can be sort of reviewed and monitored on an ongoing basis.
Thank you,
Camilla. I didn't get a sense of there, sorry, to come in on how you would be evaluating that, but maybe when you're responding to Mr. Dorris, the supplementary, we might be able to pick out a bit more on the evaluation of the MRCs.
I think that would be very helpful. Camilla, can I welcome to your position, Minister? I think the exchange with Mr. McGuire was really helpful, because I think the committee has a better understanding of the policy intent behind the changes to terminology of movement restriction conditions. If that needs to be tightened up, I think the committee would welcome that, and we'll have our stage one report in due course. But we've repeatedly heard of the challenges with the changes to MRCs. We've not heard very much about potential opportunities, and I wouldn't want that to get lost within our stage one report. So can the Minister maybe take the opportunity to talk about what the opportunities may be in relation to, I'm assuming that an MRC is less restrictive than secure, which may be better for a young person, or a young person insecure. That's a big jump to have a full restoration of liberty, and an MRC could be deployed as part of a pathway back into the community. But we've not heard very much about that. So would you anticipate more MRCs being used after this bill is passed? Yes, how would that be monitored? The convener's absolutely right. And what might the potential benefits be?
Thank you, Mr. Dordis. No, absolutely. I don't want to sort of foresee anything, but it could very well be the fact that there would be more MRCs following the enactment of this bill. To date, there have been very few MRCs used in practice, and that's perhaps something due to the consistency in the tests. So as a result of the fact that there have been very few MRCs to date, there has been limited options to assess or evaluate their use and effectiveness. However, as has already been detailed in evidence to the committee and via the call for views, it is recognised that MRCs in certain circumstances can be a very effective measure to support children to remain in the community. As you said, secure care will be a very, very punitive measure. So it's to allow them to stay within the community, although still with that restriction, and whilst being provided with intensive support and appropriate restrictions on their movements. So I think it's just kind of, it's given another option prior to that kind of final placement in a secure care setting.
What are here, convener? I think the convener's question around how this will be monitored becomes more and more pertinent. We've heard in evidence sessions witnesses saying we don't want to set young people up to fail by putting an MRC in place that will find it really tough to comply with. And you mentioned that should there be breaches of MRCs, then there'll be a review of the order in place, and that there'll be a fresh children's panel held. I think that would pretty much have to be done in short order if MRCs were instead of a secure accommodation disposal by the children's panel. So what reassurances can you give either today or perhaps follow up in writing that how quickly children's panels are set up to carry out that review, have that children's panel and decide whether the MRC needs to be reviewed, kept in place, or indeed the young person moved on to secure?
There's a lot in there, Minister, yeah, do your best to unpick that one.
There is. I mean, in my previous response, I did advise that the scheduling of those hearings for the reviews of MRCs will be prioritised, given that potential need for further restrictive measures or looking around it. In terms of what you were saying about the child, we absolutely don't want to put the onus on the child. So this is why this will be reviewed and ongoing. And if there are any potential changes or further improvements that can be made in terms of monitoring that or evaluating the effectiveness of that, then that's certainly something that can be taken forward. But at the moment, because I've said that we're kind of relying on such a limited number of MRCs, then it's harder to give that sort of data. Our reassurance.
Right, thanks, Minister. Thank you. Continue.
We're going to jump back a little bit because Pam Duncan Clancy has a supplementary on one of our earlier things that I admitted to bring her in on, so apologies. And then, so let's move to Pam Duncan Clancy, please.
Thank you, convener, and I appreciate the opportunity to go back a bit. I welcome the minister to her new role. I want to go back to some of the questions that my colleague Stephen Kerr raised around age, and the financial memorandum minister notes that in practice, the cut-off to access the children's hearing is going to be about 17 and a half years, not 18. And witnesses have argued that this could be an arbitrary date and also could actually be because of the lengthy waits, which Sheriff Mackey has said has left children lingering in the system and actually could contravene the UNCRC, which you yourself have said is incredibly important to that. So can I ask, is the delay in the system the real reason 17 and a half has been mentioned? Is it justifiable on any other grounds than slow processing? And how will the Minister make the bill compatible with the UNCRC when you bring it back, if this is the case?
Well, I think So thank you for the question, first of all. And I think there has to be a cut-off somewhere. Logistically, when you're looking at this, there absolutely has to be. Obviously, the bill raises the age of referral of the principal reporter to 18, but as you've mentioned, as the members mentioned, as detailed in the financial memorandum, due to the time taken for a referral to the reporter to progress and for a hearing to convene and put meaningful measures in place which can take effect, it is expected that the Lord Advocate, when reviewing the current guidelines, will consider if a kind of formalised cut-off age is needed so that an offence can still be appropriately dealt with. Now, we've obviously said that for those going into secure care, you could enter into secure care possibly up to your 19th birthday, and this is to allow those children who would be sentenced, perhaps a short sentence just prior to their 18th birthday, to not enter into a young offenders institution. So it's that safeguard there. But I'm sure the member will agree that because we're looking at the rights of a child, there does have to be a cut-off somewhere. And I would say that's logistic.
I appreciate that, but in that answer, Minister, there were three cut-offs. There's 17 and a half, there's 18 and there's 19. So which one is it? The UNCRC says the relevant date is the date on which the alleged offence, if we call it that, happened. So surely that should be the relevant date.
Well, it's not been formalised yet, but it's something that going forward will be. As I've said, we don't have a formalised cut-off date at the moment. We have said that, I think, in terms of safeguarding and protecting children, we've allowed it to go up to 19 for secure care centres. At the moment, we're saying 17 and a half, there's not a formalised cut-off date.
OK, thank you. If it's OK, I'll move on to further area. Thank you, Convener. The committee's heard from victims of offences that are committed by children are not given the breadth of information which could be afforded to victims of offences by adults. Has the Minister considered whether a more equitable approach to providing such information to all victims of crime be given further consideration?
Yeah, this is a really finely balanced area in terms of upholding the rights of the person that's committed the offence, and of course the victim. So mm-hmm. That has been something that has had very, very strong considerations. Crucially, at the end of the day, children's hearings are not criminal justice settings, and the rights, the rights of the victim within those settings must be really carefully balanced against the rights of the child in question. I know that evidence provided that you've already heard and via your written calls for evidence have highlighted the range of views on this matter and the challenges faced in balancing, and that kind of fine balancing act that I've spoken about. I consider that the bill strikes the right balance between the needs of victims and the principles that inform and underpin the children's hearing system. And just to reassure the member, we have listened carefully to points made on information sharing during the evidence sessions and will continue to do so as the bill progresses through Parliament.
Thank you, Minister. And what conversations have you had with the Information Commissioner with regards to this?
Having been very new to the role, that is not a conversation that I myself have had. I will pass over to my officials to speak on that.
Yeah, so in the course of last year and formulating the provisions and the drafting of the bill, I mean, there was ongoing engagement with the Information Commissioner's Office. It's a statutory obligation of that. So that was done kind of across the bill, not just on this particular issue. And I know there was a representative that sort of gave evidence on it as well. I suppose, as Ms Dawn said, the way that the bill was approached is, the principles of UNCRC and the ethos on which the hearing system was founded upon. The bill doesn't make sort of seismic changes to the hearing system's kind of approach and how that has been for children and certain children that are 16 and 17 up to now, who were already going through that system. And it was something that was, there was a lot raised on it in our consultation. Views were quite polarised on where that should go, but that crucial point about it not being a criminal justice setting and the principles that the hearing system is founded on still ringing true is where it's been approached. But I mean, as Ms Dunn says, we are listening to what's coming forward. We do hear a lot of the views coming and sort of are considering that and look forward to what the committee has to say in its stage one report on the issue as well to buttress that.
Thank you. I just have one final question, and it's short.
Absolutely.
Thank you. The Sheriff Mackey noted that restorative justice allows victims to participate, and the hearing system doesn't have that. What can you do to make that happen so that victims can feel that justice is served?
Thank you, Convener. Well, there are updated regulations within the bill that give more allow the hearing system to update the witness on not necessarily the outcome of the hearing system, but give details on when that will be taking place. We absolutely do recognise that restorative justice seeks to ensure the needs of those harmed, and their voices are absolutely central. This obviously can support accountability and responsibility for those children that cause harm. Scottish ministers are funding posts within the Children and Young People's Centre for Justice to support the development of those restorative justice services, because we recognise that requirements and the needs of those accessing the service might differ when those young people are involved. So there are that is underway and a priority.
Okay, thank you.
Interesting to see and learn how that develops. Can I move to questions now from Bill Kidd, please?
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener, and welcome to the Minister and your team here today. Thank you. Now, I don't want to go over things that you might think we've covered already, but to talk a wee bit more about age ranges and such like, supervision or guidance of post-18-year-olds is an important aspect. And I do think that because of the variations amongst young people in terms of their developmental processes, I think it's important to look at the idea of an age limit not being a cliff edge of support. This has come up during multiple evidence sessions. And I think it's very important that we know what consideration the Scottish Government and the Bill team has given to this and what might be done to encourage successful transitions from the age group of 16, 17 when someone becomes 18.
Thank you, Mr. Kidd. we absolutely, I have already touched on this in previous responses, but we did consider extending compulsory measures beyond 18 using the children's hearing system. But the system itself is completely designed around making decisions about compulsory orders on children, with relevant persons also having rights to the child. The test currently applied is that compulsory orders can only be made if necessary to safeguard or promote welfare throughout childhood, and any extension beyond the age of 18 would require an entirely new framework for the system, and the tests needed to justify compulsion beyond childhood would require to be altered and restated to accommodate the rights of that young adult. This could also cause capacity issues in the system, and volunteer panel members would require to be trained and supported in decision making in relation to young people as opposed to children. So this hasn't been taken forward, and I know that in their written evidence, SCRA agreed with this approach.
Can I just follow up slightly, just to say, I mean, I think from what you've said, which is perfectly reasonable as far as it goes, that we have to hope that when a post-18-year-old is then moved into the next stage, that there are people who are trained and capable in that stage to be able to help someone forward, rather than just saying, well, that's your age now, so too bad, or something, you know, if you know what I mean. I don't want to, you know.
No, absolutely. We don't want it to just be a case of, oh, well, that's you 18, so right, you can just kind of go on and deal with it. Absolutely. Obviously, this is specific to under-18s, but in many areas, Scotland is still developing a really distinct approach to young people aged between 18 and 25 years. So this includes, for example, the Scottish Sentencing Council's guidelines, and I've already touched on that, the extension of the whole system approach under the Youth Justice Vision, and youth court pilots, and this will all continue to be monitored to provide learning for future considerations for those between 18 to 25. But absolutely, we want the support to be there for that age.
That's useful to know. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Kidd. And now, can we go back to questions from Mr. Bob Dorris, please?
Thanks very much, Convener. Just a couple of a brief questions, Minister. The bill includes a number of provisions seeking to enhance the rights of children who have been detained in police custody that they currently would not have. Could you maybe expand on what you feel those provisions are and how they will benefit young people in those situations?
I'm sorry, Mr. Dorris, I missed the very beginning of your question, if you could...
So, at the moment, young people, depending whether they're part of the children's system already or 16 and 17 years or not, don't have the same rights in police custody. This will extend additional rights to young people in relation to police custody. Could you say a little bit, Minister, about what those are and what benefits those will be for young people?
Absolutely, Mr. Dorris. Thank you for repeating that for me. The bill increases the opportunities for local authority notifications and visits. So that includes the ability for the local authority to advise intimation should not be sent to a parent or a named adult if they feel that that might be detrimental to the well-being of that child. And the aim in that is to ensure that every child has an appropriate person notified and that no child is left in police custody without being visited by either a parent, another adult or the local authority. Second to that, the bill also extends considerations for keeping children in a place of safety prior to attendance at court, as well as helping ensure that a solicitor is present during police interviews. And I know that Police Scotland provided evidence on how the current provisions work in practice, and the Scottish Government are in ongoing dialogue with Police Scotland on the potential implications of this bill in this light.
OK, thanks, Minister. I won't dwell on this aspect. It's been a pretty uncontentious part of the legislation, but I would note that I think young people are not able to waive their right to legal representation. There's always a legal representative there, which is an additional protection. I did nudge witnesses last week about whether or not that young people should never be detained in a police station or otherwise. I'm not saying that's necessarily my view, Minister, but it has been suggested that a place of safety should never be a police station unless impracticable, Minister, that I'm now stumbling over. So can I ask you whether you think there is a case where it should be on the face of the bill that no young person should ever be detained in a police station, or if that's not the case, in what circumstances do you think would be unavoidable?
I think that's something that we would absolutely like to work towards, but at the moment I'm not entirely sure that is logistically possible. The law at the moment requires that police must take every precaution to ensure that a person is not unreasonably or unnecessarily held in police custody. And a number of incidents at the present moment are dealt with in the community, and there has been no need to arrest the children or bring them into police custody at all. The Lord Advocate has issued guidelines on this separately, and in deciding to bring a child into police custody, there are a number of various factors that are considered, including the rights of that specific child, the possibility of interference with victims or witnesses, the severity of the offence, and the need to fully investigate the offence. So there are issues there that could make an impact on whether that child needs to be brought into police custody. When an arrest is absolutely necessary, currently the police must, by law, take all arrested persons, and that includes children, to a police station. And this could be necessary, as I say, to prevent further offending, to facilitate investigations such as capturing fingerprints, photographs or DNA. And the decision to keep a person in custody must comply with Lord Advocate's guidelines. So what I'm saying is, I think this is something that we would definitely like to work towards. It wasn't consulted on as part of this bill because there are, as I say, logistical issues around how that takes place. But yeah, that's something that we can certainly look at and going forward.
That's helpful, Minister. No further questions.
Thank you. The committee did hear from Social Work Scotland Minister that it's almost inconceivable that police custody will not have to be used for under-18s, and the important line is for a number of years to come. So how would the Minister respond to this point, and will local authorities be expected to use secure care as an alternative to custody? And if so, what are the cost implications of this?
So secure care would be a very much a last resort for police custody in terms of the costings for that. I would probably have to hand over to officials to give the costings.
If they can assist.
I think on that point, secure care can only be used in very limited circumstances if a child's in police custody. All other alternative places of safety should be being considered, and the legislation's very clear that secure care is one of a range of places of safety, but if a child is going to be placed in secure care, they would still have to meet the secure care criteria, which isn't always the case, and in that situation, a child couldn't be placed in secure care. The costs for secure care are, you know, in excess of £6,000 a week. So there would be cost implications if secure care was to be considered. However, the cost implications are almost secondary. That child has to meet the secure care criteria to be placed in secure care, as opposed to police custody. And really, the drive should be to look at what alternative places of safety can be used in that situation. There is work ongoing with local authorities and the Scottish Police Authority at the current time, looking at what are the approaches to places of safety, what alternatives can be used and what else might need to be developed or considered in these situations.
So can I come back to you then, Ms Nolan? Does that mean that we can foresee that police custody will be used for under-18s for a number of years to come?
Well, I don't think we can forecast for how long, but I think what we can say is there is a consensus across the board that we should not be keeping children in police custody, firstly, but secondly, a longer-term aim that we don't need to bring children into police custody at all. There's plans and work underway to try to achieve those realities, involving a range of stakeholders and a range of partners to make that a reality. How long that work will take, we don't know, because it's fundamentally linked to other developments that are taking place as well.
Right, thank you for that. Can I move to questions now from Ben McPherson, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and to your officials. I've just got a number of questions around the restrictions on reporting. So, first of all, you'll be aware that stakeholders have called for greater legal certainty around when reporting restrictions begin to apply to child suspects, witnesses and suspected victims. Therefore, what assessment has the Scottish Government made of these calls, and will the legislation be strengthened in this regard as we go into the further stages?
Thank you, Mr McPherson. Before court proceedings where a suspected offence involves children, those children, including victims and witnesses, will benefit from automatic reporting restrictions. A court can currently dispense with reporting restrictions only if this is in the interests of justice. And this extended protection is important, as the implications of a child being identified are similar and significant at whatever stage proceedings are at. And if identified during a police investigation, this undermines the protection offered by the presumption of anonymity during subsequent court proceedings. This is something that we are, in direct response to the Minister's question, Mr McPherson's question, this is something that we are considering. Sorry, I'm thinking a few weeks past.
Minister, carry on.
And thank you, Minister, for your answer. And just by way of a follow-up, and in that constructive spirit of your response, I just want to draw attention, not necessarily for answer today, but for consideration into the further part of Stage 1 and then into Stage 2, response 97066875 by Dr Andrew Tuchel and Sinead Stevenson-McCabe from Glasgow University. Caledonian University, rather. They've made some comment around these new reporting restrictions. And of course, since this bill's publication, and in recent weeks, we've seen the publication of the Victims Bill. And I just would be grateful if the government could consider the points around consistency with regard to those pieces of legislation in terms of complainer anonymity the comparisons between the two bits of legislation. I just want to raise that point. Feel free to take it away.
Absolutely. I can make a brief response to that. This is something that the government will continue to assess any potential differences in provisions between the two bills. As noted in the policy memorandum for the bill, the Scottish Government did commit in its 2022 programme for government to introduce a bill which will make provision granting a statutory right of automatic lifelong anonymity to complainers in sexual offence cases. The Victim Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill delivers on that commitment by providing for an automatic lifelong right of anonymity to the victims and other offences of limited scope, which share the same underlying concerns. Now, it should be noted that the provisions governing restrictions on publication of identifying information insofar as they extend to victims' offence cases in this bill and certain other limited offences are subject to change in the future, given the planned provisions on automatic anonymity for complainers, as Mr McPherson has referred to. So, for assurance, we will continue to assess any differences in provisions between the two bills as each continue to go forward under parliamentary scrutiny.
Thank you, Minister.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Minister, provisions in the bill will ensure that no child under the age of 18 can be held in a young offender's institution or prison, either on remand while awaiting sentence or having been sentenced, including for very serious crimes. Could the Minister expand on the rationale for including serious crimes, or all crimes rather, in the policy for the detention of young people? And have any concerns about the policy been raised by victims, organisations or others, particularly in regard to the serious offending, and what are the concerns and how might they be allayed? So again, there's a lot in there, hopefully. Yeah.
So I think the kind of key priority is that the Scottish Government are committed to keeping children out of prison, and that is the key word, children. We are classing 16 and 17 year olds as children, and when looking at the hearing system, it's not based on the specific offence or the specific age. In terms of secure care already deal with some of the most serious offences. So they are already equipped to deal with children who have committed serious offences. Those at the moment are under 16. But I know that the committee has heard strong evidence from Secure Care that they are equipped and able to deal with 16, 17-year-olds who have committed these serious offences. And I go back to what I said at the beginning. While I appreciate there are concerns around that, the Lord Advocate still does have the right to try a child in a criminal court, although it will end in a secure care setting rather than a YOI. But this is back to what I was saying in my opening comments to Mr Kerr. It's about rehabilitation of the child and giving that child the best chance to not reoffend again. And a secure care centre is definitely the most appropriate setting for that to be the case.
But what would you say in response to some of the challenges and the criticism from the victims' organisations around that to allay the concerns that they might have? What might you specifically say to those organisations?
I would specifically say that this is something that we will continue to monitor. We will work with the secure care. We will work with local authorities. We're in discussions with them now. This is not something that I'm shying away from, but as I've clearly said, and as the committee have heard strong evidence on, the secure care centres have said that they are equipped to manage this, and are comfortable with this. Obviously, the we also have the Reimagining Secure Care project underway, and that's again something that may feed back into this. So again, it's not something that we're not looking at. It's something that we're working on and happy to take any feedback as we go on from that.
Thank you, Minister. Can Stephanie Callaghan, can I come to you now for your questions? Thank you.
Yes, certainly. Thank you very much. I'm switched on. I couldn't hear myself there. So, Minister, whether the children, young people in secure care are secured in welfare or offence grounds, they are the most highly vulnerable and highly at risk in Scotland. And this bill will bring changes for secure accommodation providers because we'll be accommodating older young people and also those who've committed serious offences, as the convener spoke about there. So two questions, really.
Firstly, what care and support needs are you anticipating for those young people with the most serious offences? And secondly, how will staff who currently work in secure care settings be trained and supported to do that role?
So there's a range of measures underway, and this is absolutely under consideration. Secure care is more appropriate for 16 and 17-year-olds, as I've already mentioned. The environment is age-appropriate and child-centred, with work, focused work, to help address the child's specific behaviours. A therapeutic and educational setting, as I've already referred to, can help lead children to healthier development, better outcomes, and decrease the likelihood of future offending. Secure care is the right setting to better support children who require to be deprived of their liberty, to address those underlying needs and causes of the behaviours, to help children to reintegrate, to recover, to rehabilitate and desist, which in turn will reduce future victims and will benefit society as a whole. I don't see... Children are not mini adults. The propensity for a child to alter their behaviour and change their path can be far, far greater than adults, and that's something I've already referred to this morning. Safe and trusting relationships are the absolute cornerstone of promoting children's healthy development and positive outcomes. And through the provision of 24/7 care, the relationships that secure care staff can provide are absolutely key. So I know that was something the member mentioned specifically. The knowledge, skills, training and ratios of staff, often 2-to-1, are supportive to the development of such relationships. Staff in secure care centres must be registered and qualified in relation to care and education. And the care-based, child-centred ethos and environment secure care affords is supported by the centres and registered, monitored and inspected by the Care Inspectorate and Education Scotland. So I hope that goes to answer the member's question.
Yep, thanks for that answer there. So there is really a change. You know, there will be a lot more time with those people who have committed serious offences as well there. And yet care providers were very supportive of the bill, but they're also very, very clear about the fact that there are very real risks around accommodating those older young people. Sometimes who've had very serious or sometimes even gruesome offences have been committed, and making sure that we take those risks really seriously. Obviously, there's a huge amount of importance around their expertise, but what they've been talking about as well is looking to be able to group children and young people together in groups that are quite safe, etc. there as well. And can you give some reassurance that you will be working closely with those directly involved in secure care? Because they do have the expertise and the specialist training, like you said there, to understand those complex needs and really be working with them to actually find a way forward in this.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's as I've mentioned earlier, each child's care, even within a secure care centre, is focused on a case-by-case basis. So that is defined by the child and what that child needs in terms of support. Secure accommodation centres already utilise a range of interventions and strategies to meet the needs of all children, to ensure that their safety is maintained and that risk is managed. So that's important for what the member was referring to in terms of those most serious offences. Risk assessment and risk management frameworks allow for decisions about the level of care, the supervision and restrictions on a child to be bespoke, proportionate and tailored to the needs of that specific child. So what I was referring to in terms of a case-by-case basis. And this is both to ensure the safety, their safety, and the safety of those others in that secure centre. So we've no plans to change this or separate children placed in secure based on considerations like their route into secure care, age or offence type. But all this will be monitored, and yes, absolutely, we will listen, we will work with, and we will continue to monitor this as we go forward.
And just a very short question, I suppose, as well, just to check that you'll be happy to build in, you know, when you're doing that work alongside providers, that you'll be happy to build in and take seriously any need for flexibility and around infrastructure, etc., as well, there to make sure that they're able to work effectively with those young people.
Absolutely, that's something that will be taken into consideration.
Thank you.
And I've got my eye on the clock, Minister, so we are going to extend the session, but we still need some really concise responses as well as concise questions as we move forward. Can I move to Willie Rennie, please? Thank you.
Thanks very much, Convener, and welcome to the Minister to our new position. Do you have an estimate about how many additional places will require in secure units as a result of this change?
Yes, sorry, I do have figures in front of me, but at the moment, so figures tend to fluctuate, so I don't necessarily want to put an exact figure on it and say that that is going to be the case going forward. At the moment, there are currently five under-18s in Young Offenders Institute, and as of the 2nd of May, there were seven places vacant. I know that from previous, these figures have changed in the lead up to this committee, and it has generally been around that that level.
Okay. When we went to Polmont, we saw that the NHS was providing, they were integrated into the Young Offenders Institution and they were directly providing the NHS care. It seemed that they were able to get everything that they needed when they needed it because of that specialist dedicated support. We didn't have independent verification that the service was to the standard we'd like, but nevertheless, it was provided directly. That's not the case with the secure units. Have you got any plans to change that?
So secure care centres currently do have trained practitioners and professionals that are based either within that secure care or specialists which they can bring in to respond to the needs of children within their care. At the moment, there are no plans to change legislation around that access to health professionals. However, officials are working with mental health colleagues to consider the specialist healthcare needs which many children in secure care might require and what additional supports are available or could be made available within the community. And as I say, this is something that will continue to be monitored throughout the passage of the bill and further forward.
I mean, when we went to a secure unit, we saw that through the good efforts of the staff there, that they had built up good relationships with the local health providers. There were issues sometimes when the individuals came from health boards outside the area, so there was the continuity of care was an issue. But it was mostly done by the connections and the good service and the integration was done by their goodwill. That's not guaranteed to always be the case. I mean, is it a possibility that you could look at the NHS providing direct support to make sure that it's more coordinated and seamless in the future? Is that a possibility?
As I said, this is something that will be monitored to go on, so I don't rule anything out. Just in response to your point, something else that we are currently looking at, we are committed to funding the Interventions for Vulnerable Youth Service, which is currently hosted at Kibble. A member might be aware of that. Ivy is a specialist psychological and social work service, which provides three types of service: professional consultation and advice, psychological assessment and psychological intervention for children who are at risk of harm to others. And this can include support to those on the edge of secure care and those within secure care settings. So that is something that we're working on, we're committed to currently. But as I say, in terms of going forward, I wouldn't rule anything out.
Okay, that's fine. So there's quite a lot of young people placed in the secure units from outside Scotland. We have had reports that some of those authorities are paying higher rates than the funding provided through the Scottish system. Are we dependent on those places to keep the secure units adequately funded? Are you comfortable with those differential rates?
So, at the moment, we've been quite clear that we do believe that cross-border placements do need to be reduced. I don't want to say ended entirely because, as I think I've already mentioned this morning, there are exceptional circumstances where these require to go ahead. In terms of funding for secure care, the member will be aware that the Scottish Government is currently funding the last bed in the secure care centres to keep capacity for Scottish for children within Scotland, and that is helping with the capacity and funding issues. But again, that's something that will need to be monitored going forward. I am actually meeting with Claire Coutinho, Minister within the UK Government, to discuss the issue of cross-border placements. I've just had my meeting finalised with her this morning. While that's just a kind of introductory meeting at the moment, the issue of cross-border placements will be coming up, because regardless of the financial circumstances, it is something that we do want to see minimised and only used where deemed absolutely necessary for the safeguarding of that child.
Can I just go back?
Mr. Rennie, some of those questions were assigned to one of our colleagues, your colleagues, for later on. Yeah.
All right.
But that's fine. I'm just...
No, I can conclude on that point. I thought it was under...
Sorry.
It is connected with what additional resource will be required to provide the extra places within the secure units. You've indicated the kind of scale of it, but have you done some calculations around about what work will be required in those secure units?
Absolutely, this is ongoing work. The full details for what we currently have at the moment are set out in the financial memorandum. I am just going to pass over to my officials to go through some of that in more detail, if you're happy to come in, Brendan.
Yeah, Mr. Rennie. Yeah, I mean, I know that there's been evidence on the kind of commercial viability factor for secure care centres runs at about 90%, occupancy levels. And that sort of commercial element of it will be there and sort of always exist. And we are looking at, secure care capacity, training, accommodation across the estate alongside the bill. But the cross-border element of it is still there. The bill takes measures to try and, disincentivise that along with the ethos of the promise and kind of wider government ambition. The figures are sort of looked at within that context. I suppose the numbers going to secure care will always fluctuate. Numbers of children over, I think, a 10-year period coming before Scottish courts are down something like 85%. So there are, huge strides that have been made over recent years on kind of numbers of children coming into contact with criminal justice services or offending. But the numbers for secure care and cross-border sort of do fluctuate. But the measures in the bill are designed to sort of disincentivise the commercialisation of the current cross-border element to those placements.
Okay, that's fine.
Thank you. Pam Duncan-Clancy, do you want to take your briefs up on this theme now and we'll round it off? I will.
Thank you, Convener. And I've listened carefully to the responses that you just gave. The committee also understands that the pilot to fund and retain the one bed in secure centres will be extended to March 24. However, there's not anything included in the bill. So how will that be addressed going forward? And I suspect my colleagues will pick up more on the finances. But actually, given the answers we've just had, I'm quite worried about the financial sustainability of the system, because I don't see much of that backfilling in the financial memorandum.
I think... We need to recognise the wider backdrop to this. So this will, over time, be a saving for society and for public expenditure going forward. As I've said, the financial memo sets out the headline cost and was produced via in-depth engagement with partners and duty bearers. And given the nature, my officials have pointed out, given the nature of care and justice services, there is a really high degree of variability. So it can be difficult, perhaps, to forecast. But the Scottish Government has not wanted to avoid underestimating in many areas. So there are high financial implications. But as I've said, it is important to recognise the wider backdrop, that the benefits that these change programmes could have for society and public expenditure going forward. I think you had another question tacked on to that. Sorry, Miss.
Specifically about the cross-border gap. So if, a lot of secure care has said that the cross-border placements really do sustain it, as my colleague Willa Rennie has highlighted, how are you going to fill that gap?
I think you originally asked the in terms of the last beds, if this is going to be increased. So we don't require legislative change for that. That will be something that is taken forward, not necessarily within the implications of this bill.
Didn't quite get the question. The answer, rather, to your second question around the funding element. But maybe funding, maybe colleagues can pick it up under the financial aspect of things.
Yeah, as I've said, this does tend to fluctuate. I'm more than happy to write to the committee with more information on the exact costings around that as we move forward, if that's something that the committee would like.
I would certainly appreciate
more some detail. Thank you, Pam.
Thank you.
The bill does not include any measures to end restraint in secure accommodation, and this has been described as a missed opportunity, with stakeholders stating legislation will be needed to make progress on this issue. So how is the Scottish Government going to address the issue of restraint?
Well, following consideration of the responses to the consultation, I am content that there's already sufficient legislative provision to enable secure transport to be utilised when necessary and to ensure the safety...
Sorry,
and the
I'm not asking about secure transport. I'm asking about restraint in secure accommodation.
That's fine, thank you, Convener, and I'm happy to get to your question, sorry. I know that that's something that was raised with during the evidence sessions and during the written evidence. Apologies. But as I said, looking through the consultation and following careful consideration of the responses to the consultation itself, the Scottish Government is content that additional legislative provision in relation to restraint is not necessary to ensure the safety of the child and others. This is because an overly prescriptive approach to minimising restraint practices could bring adverse consequences around escalation and criminalisation, and instead ministers consider that a blended framework of regulation, guidance, practice support and precise reporting is likely to best serve Scotland's children. Work is ongoing with partners to reduce and, where possible, completely eliminate the use of restraint in respect of children in care. So this includes working with the Scottish Physical Restraint Action Group to explore definitions of restraint, along with the availability of data, training and support.
When we visited Polmont, it was literally 2 or 3 days after the first ever use of soft cuffs. So in terms of the rollout of that as a method of restraint and a progress, I suppose, of it being less painful, a pain-free method of restraint, is that something you are looking to make standard?
That's something that could certainly be considered, yes.
Okay. So we are now going to move on to questions regarding transport from my colleague Ross Greer. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'd like to come back to the point of standards around secure transport, and specifically points around restraint. But just to start off with, Minister, you'll be familiar with the evidence that the committee has received around provision of secure transport and the anecdotal evidence that we've had that most secure transport providers are based in England, and you know there are instances of a young person being taken from one side of Glasgow to the other or from Montrose to Nine Wells Hospital, and they need to call up transport from south of London. Portsmouth, I think, was one of the examples given. Does the Scottish Government recognise that there is an issue with availability of secure transport provision in Scotland, and why do you think that's the case? We've been trying to find out from witnesses in past sessions, is this a question of market failure? Is it about procurement practices? Is there something else going on? Because it seems a significant problem if we're having to call up cars from Portsmouth to take somebody on a half-hour journey across one city in Scotland.
Absolutely, and yes, do recognise that this is a problem. In terms of exactly why, I wouldn't want to say exactly, although there could be issues around the fact that this isn't a regulated or a registered service, so I can confirm that further consideration is underway as to who is best placed to provide that service and that secure transport going forward. So this includes consideration of whether secure transport should be a regulated, registered service and who should do so, which should provide more solidity around that.
Really welcome that, Minister. Just to clarify that, is that consideration being undertaken as part of this bill, i.e. with a view to or being open to the potential for amendments at stage two or three that would, for example, give ministers the regulation-making powers if the decision was taken to regulate and establish a registration system?
Yes, that would go forward with the bill. So that is something that we're, as I say, currently looking at.
Fantastic. And on the question of standards in transport, you mentioned a minute ago on the wider issue of the use of restraint in secure accommodation provision that you're looking at a mix of regulation, guidance and precise reporting. One of the issues that's been made very clear to us is there's no consistency in reporting around the use of restraint in a transport setting. Sometimes the secure accommodation provider is informed by the transport provider, sometimes they're not, sometimes the local authority might be informed, sometimes they won't. As part of what you've just said, their consideration to amendments, is the government considering a consistent reporting requirement on transport providers or whoever responsibility would lie with? The consistent reporting requirement could be on the accommodation provider and it's then an onus on them to find out from transport provider. But is the government now considering some kind of consistency, a requirement for consistency in reporting instances of restraint in transport?
I think that would make sense given if it is decided that it would be better to bring that into a sort of regulated service, because at the moment, as Mr Greer has mentioned, information on the use of handcuffs during secure transport is arranged by local authorities, it's not held centrally, so there are issues around that. So in short answer to your question, yes, that's again something that can be considered.
Thanks very much. And in the interest of time, given that most of my questions were angled at persuading the government to move in this direction, you're clearly already moving in it. Just on principle, does the government think that there is ever a situation in which the use of handcuffs in a transport setting would be appropriate?
If it was to protect the child itself or to protect other people, then that would be a decision for the person. So I don't know if I'm best to say yes or no, because I wouldn't be dealing with the incident. I wouldn't be dealing with what has been involved. But I can understand why there could be instances where restraint would be necessary. But it's about ensuring that this is only done in extreme or exceptional circumstances, that it's carried out appropriately.
Thanks very much. Really welcome those answers, Minister. That's all from me, Convener.
Thank you, Mr Greer. Now, can we move to some questions led by my Vice Convener, Mr Ben McPherson, please?
Thank you, Convener. And there's been some mention throughout the different subjects on the financial considerations and the resourcing of the implementation of this bill, should it be enacted. And I just wanted to ask, and colleagues may have follow-ups, the financial memorandum estimates costs of between £5.36 million and £6.56 million per annum to local government. Will the Scottish Government provide this additional funding? What engagement has it had with COSLA on this matter? Because witnesses have suggested that the financial memorandum underestimates the costs to local government. So I'd be grateful for considerations on that. Comment from the Minister.
Thank you. I've said, the financial memo sets out the headline costs and was produced via very in-depth engagement with partners and duty bearers. And given the nature of care and justice services, there is a high degree of variability involved. And as I've mentioned to other members, it is important to recognise that wider backdrop of the benefits that the change programmes could have on society going forward. The negative cost to society, both economic and social, of offending and crime and all the rest are very well documented. For instance, the Promise Follow the Money report estimates the cumulative private costs, physical and emotional harm, lost output and public service costs to be upwards of £3.9 billion. So when you look at that, there is a huge amount of money being spent in this. And although this looks like large costs going forward, putting those, balancing that off against each other, there could be real potential there. Yes, of course. I thought you wanted to come in.
I think the points you make around preventative spend and the positive impact on that in terms of society and the public finances are absolutely well understood and within the Christie principles. In terms of getting to that point, though, of course, the implementation of this bill will require investment, both from local government and areas where central government has responsibility. And as we take this bill on its journey through Parliament, I think there will need to be consideration around the feedback that's been received from local government and Social Work Scotland as to what sunk costs will be required in terms of the implementation in order to make sure that we get on that trajectory towards preventative spend. If you don't have any further comment today, then that's understandable. But I would be interested in what engagement you or colleagues have had with COSLA on these matters, and how you intend to work through the practicalities of the financial considerations when it comes to implementation.
Thank you, Mr. McPherson. No, I mean, we're not complacent. We understand that new investment is needed to implement the bill measures and the costs associated. We have worked with partners to quantify the financial memorandum, which outlines around £11 million per year of additional spend. So we are listening to views coming forward at stage one and will, of course, consider where further work can be done as scrutiny progresses, and more than happy to keep the committee again updated on that. I do have a visit to the Finance Committee next week where we'll be discussing some of the finances in more detail.
Okay.
I'm okay just now.
Thank you, Mr. McPherson. Stephen Kerr has some questions on this financial
Minister,
aspect.
Just for the sake of brevity, do you accept what COSLA are saying about the inaccuracy of the costings in the financial memorandum, specifically around the social work costs? Do you accept what they're saying?
I accept what they're saying. Witnesses are absolutely more than welcome to give their opinion. I've already said that the numbers do fluctuate, so I don't think there are inaccuracies, but these do need to be updated.
So I'm a bit confused because you say you accept that there are inaccuracies.
No, I don't accept. You asked me if I accepted what they said, and I said I accept what they said. Witnesses are free to say
what... As factual.
No, that would so be of agree. Their opinion.
So you don't agree that COSLA's evidence is factual?
Sorry?
You don't agree that COSLA's evidence is factual?
I
think we're going around in circles here.
Okay. Do you accept that the evidence they presented is factual in its content?
Factual in its context, yes.
So
So
you agree there are inaccuracies in the financial memorandum?
Not inaccuracies.
Discrepancies?
Yes, updated.
It needs to be updated. Do you also accept what they say about the fact that there is no facility to transfer costs from the criminal justice system to local government?
Well, I accept what they say in terms of local government funding. Mr. Kerr is perfectly aware of how that works, and so I'm not going to get into that at the moment for the interest of time.
We have some time.
So you would like me to go through the authority funding settlement?
Stephen, Mr. Kerr, can I just come in? I think
yes.
I want to... We heard a lot of evidence around the concerns. When you've spoken yourself about the long-term aspirations and cost savings that this will make to society. What we are saying is that right now there is no mechanism to transfer the savings from the justice system into local government, children, families and social work. And what is the government going to do to address that imbalance?
Well, we're listening to views, and as I've been very clear throughout this entire committee session, that we're happy to look at this going forward. There's no plans for that at the moment, no, but that's something that can be addressed going forward if the requirement is there.
Yeah. So what I'm trying to do is unpack what COSLA told us about the implications for costs arising from what is in the financial memorandum accompanying the bill. And they highlight, as has already been said, the impact on social services in terms of the inaccuracy of the costs. I'm still not clear whether you accept what they're saying in the basic... I'll move on that. Do you also accept the issue about the difficulty, if perhaps in the view of COSLA, impossibility of transferring savings that will occur theoretically in the criminal justice system into local government in order to, as was outlined by the convener? What was your response to that?
I believe the Minister's responded to my saying that it would be
considered... I didn't catch...
Yes.
Well, it was answered, Mr. Kerr, said that they were listening to, but it wasn't something they were
so
at this stage doing anything to address.
Right. And then, so finally, the point that Cosla makes is in relation to the additional resource required for the local area support teams, the people who actually arrange the children's hearings. Do you accept that they're going to need increased costs for a whole range of staff and functions that they don't currently fulfil?
If they require extra funding, then that is simply the case. And as I've said, that will have to be looked at going forward once the bill has progressed.
But it is critical to the function of what will be required by statute of local authorities. You accept that?
I'm sorry,
what would be statute. Therefore, the government will meet the funding requirements in order to make that happen, will they?
The government will meet the funding requirements required to enact the bill and the provisions within the bill.
Oh, right.
Well, I can't give any further information
That is a significant, that's a significant comment.
Mr Kerr, I've got a number of other members wanting to come in on this.
I think that's a significant thing that the Minister just said. Okay. The government will fund the additional costs.
I've got Pam has asked to come in first, if you don't mind. Pam Duncan Clancy, please.
Thank you for that. I just have two small points on what's been raised. The point about transferring funding from justice to other services, how do your justice colleagues feel about that?
I'm sorry, how do my justice colleagues feel about that?
About moving some of the money from that system.
So as far as I'm aware, that is not going ahead at the moment. But what I've said is that can be looked at going forward. That's...
And then final supplementary from yourself.
Thank you. My other question was on inaccuracies that Social Work Scotland have highlighted, and they have called them inaccuracies in uprating, meaning the financial memorandum, as they've said, is out by £500,000. So they've asked specifically, and I'd be keen to hear your view on this, Minister, what's your view on updating the estimates for inflation before there is a bid made for the budget, so that there is the situation that arose with the Care of Scotland Bill in 2015, which missed 8 years of inflation by 2023, so it would avoid that. Are you prepared to commit to do that?
So I agree that should be uprated, and as I've mentioned to the committee, I am going to be going through the financial details of this in more in greater detail at the Finance Committee next week. I'd encourage members to tune into that for more information in that light.
We will. Mr McPherson, sorry for making you wait so long.
No problem. Thank you, Convener. I'll just try and bring some of this together in terms of what other members, Mr Kerr and Pam Duncan Glancy, have asked. To me, it seems that you stated that you take the evidence from COSLA in good faith as their position, was how I interpreted your answer to Mr Kerr. But also, I think it's important to recall that as a parliament and as a collective, local government, national government and across party, we are committed to meeting the promise, and that's the essence of this legislation. So in that spirit, having had the feedback from local government and the feedback from other stakeholders with regarding cost, I think the message from committee is we encourage the government to have further dialogue with local government and other partners on these costings and how these are met through the budgetary process in due course should the Parliament commit to passing this legislation.
Absolutely, Mr McPherson. I think I've been very clear throughout the entirety of the committee session that we are listening and we are engaging and we are working with the relevant stakeholders at each of the different aspects of this bill, and obviously the finances being a core part of that. So, yes, absolutely.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Mr McPherson. And it's been an informative session as ever this morning. So I'd like to thank everyone for your time today. And the public part of our meeting has now concluded, and we will consider our final two agenda items in private. Thank you.